Hello, hello, hello. Spike in here with another eye-opening exposé. In today's video, I want to share with you all the satanic cult of Jehovah's Witnesses, who pose a great danger to us all and are handing over souls to Satan one knock at a time. But before I truly dive into the topic head on, I want to let everyone know the roots and the birthplace of the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, which is more commonly known as the Jehovah's Witnesses. The origin of the Jehovah's Witnesses, along with the Seventh-day Adventists and both of their founders, Charles Taze Russell and Ellen G. White, all go back to something called the Millerite Movement. Now, the Millerite movement was established by William Miller, who firmly believed that Jesus Christ would return in the year of 1843, and that shortly thereafter, Armageddon will begin. But when Jesus Christ did not return that exact year, the date was then further recalculated to March of 1844, and then again to October of 1844. Unsurprisingly, when Jesus did not return in October of 1844 as well, this date became known as the Great Disappointment. It became a major event in the history of the Millerite movement. The failure of this 1844 prophecy led to countless acts of violence against the Millerites, including the burning of churches, mob violence, and even murder. Miller and the Millerites were left as a disappointed and a shattered people. So let's shift to another very important person in our story. I will introduce to you Miss Ellen G. White. Now, Ellen G. White originally came from a family of Methodists. But when she was 9 years old, she was struck in the face by a rock that was thrown by a student at her school. She was left disfigured. She went into a coma for 3 weeks, and for her entire life, she suffered from various health problems, including nervousness, tremors, and seizures. Then, during the 1840s, her family became involved with the Millerite movement, the same as Russell would later. But White's earlier accident, in addition to the health problems it caused, also caused her to enter into visions. She herself even said that it was that exact blow to the head which allowed her to see things in heaven and to even speak with Jesus Christ. In 1844, one of the original dates is when Ellen G. White had her very first vision. In this vision, it was explained to her that 1844 was not a failure at all, and that in fact, it marked the very beginning of a special time for preparation. She was told that it was a new era and a new eon, the one that would lead to the true coming of Christ. During this vision, she was told that upon Armageddon, it was only the Seventh-day Adventist people who would be allowed into the New Jerusalem, and that all of the outsiders will be destroyed. And she was also given a new date for Jesus Christ's return to earth, which would be 1874. It was said that she had over 2,000 of different kinds of visions. So what were they like? Well, she would go into a trance, she would begin shouting the word glory, and would shout it 3 times. Then she would fall to the floor if no one would be there to catch her. And during this time, she would lay with her eyes open, completely oblivious as to what was going on around her. Sometimes, upon returning from her trance states, she would remain blind for days. Now, during these trances, she learned many things. And one of the most interesting was that at the end times, during the final confrontation with Satan, all of the sins of mankind in this world would be placed upon the devil himself, and that he would then be plunged into the lake of fire. This, of course, directly contradicts the idea that the sins of the world were actually placed upon Jesus Christ. In fact, under her theology, Satan is taking the place of Jesus Christ himself, and Charles Taze Russell couldn't agree more with her teachings. Now, you might be asking yourself, how does all of this tie in into the Jehovah Witness Watchtower Society? Well, Charles Taze Russell was born on February 16 of 1852 in Pennsylvania, and it is in fact he who founded the Jehovah's Witness organization. Note that he was born after the 1844 Millerite prophecy. So when Charles was 18, he encountered Seventh-day Adventist preaching, that of Ellen G. White, and he began to regularly attend her Bible studies. It was not long before he determined that he could not reconcile an eternal hell with a merciful God, leading to the Jehovah's Witness belief of a no-hell fire. And over the next 2 years, Russell came to question many, many other historic Christian doctrines, and he became convinced that the historic creeds betrayed what he called true Christianity. At the same time, he was heavily influenced by and adopted the Seventh-day Adventist teachings of Ellen G. White, that in fact, all originally came from the Millerite movement. Charles Taze Russell came to strictly believe that the end times had already begun in 1799, that Jesus Christ had returned invisibly in 1874, and that 1914 marked the beginning of Armageddon and was going to be the end of the world. So, just like his predecessors before Charles Taze, the year 1914 became his very version of the end of the world prophecy that obviously never came true. Shortly after, Charles Taze Russell died on October 31st of 1916 at the age of 64, achieving the deceptive agenda through his occult and Freemasonic beliefs. In fact, upon Russell's death, he was buried in Rosemont United Cemetery in Pittsburgh. His gravesite is marked by a headstone, and on top of his grave stands a 7-foot-tall pyramid memorial that was erected by the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, aka the Jehovah's Witnesses themselves. And if you look closely on the pyramid, you will discover the Freemasonic sign of the cross through the crown, just like the ones on his earlier versions and publications of his Watchtower magazines. The crazy thing is, Russell even admitted to being a Freemason himself. Check out these quotes that came out straight from the horse's mouth itself. Charles Taze Russell, the father and the founder of the Jehovah's Witness Institution and the founder of the blasphemous Watchtower magazine, is indeed a false teacher. Not only is Charles Taze Russell a Freemason, but he has also been linked to a satanic bloodline that was operating with key political and worldly figures, whose agenda has been to bring about the New World Order. We all know how important the bloodline was to Jesus Christ through David, but there is also a great importance to the bloodline of Satan, who will bring about the Antichrist through the New World Order. And of course, Russell was one of the many to be a part of this evil agenda. He is a part of the 13 Illuminati bloodlines. He himself is from the infamous Russell bloodline. So after Charles Taze's death in 1916, Joseph Franklin Rutherford, a Missouri lawyer, became the second president of the Watchtower Society the following year. Rutherford then went on to once again prophesy the end of the world to come in 1925. Fully convinced the Rutherford 1925 prophecy was true, many witnesses sold their homes and businesses and took to the road, living in cars and trucks while spreading the warning of the 1925 Armageddon prophecy and convincing multitudes of people that the end is near. As 1925 came, nothing happened, just like in 1914. And this was just another embarrassing chapter in the Jehovah Witness organization's history that was swiftly and craftily covered up. With Rutherford's passing, another era of charismatic presidents came and went with many other false end-time prophecies. The most recent, most impactful, and the most detrimental was the false prophecy of 1975. Incredibly, today most modern Jehovah Witnesses are unaware that any of these even happened. And to this very day, over 8 million deceived people worldwide have been baptized as witnesses because of Russell's false teachings, and it is only getting much worse. Today, the Watchtower Society is a multinational corporate giant, spreading its new messages of doom to every corner of the globe. Standing between God and the millions of witnesses is an autocratic ruling council called the Governing Body. Because the Jehovah Witnesses literally believe the Word of God is channeled to humanity through this elite committee alone, these men rule with unchallenged authority. Every witness is subject to their dictatorship from the cradle to the grave. Now, Raymond Frantz, the author of the book called Crisis of Conscience, was a member of the Watchtower Society's governing body for 9 of his 60 years as a Jehovah's Witness. And his account of their secret sessions is unbelievably revealing.
I must say that it was one of the most disillusioning experiences of my life. It came as a rude awakening to me to see what actually went on. I envisioned the governing body as a body of men to whom the Bible, God's Word, was the controlling force in every one of their decisions, who really dug into the scriptures to make sure that everything that they did was soundly based upon the Bible. And when I got into the governing body, I found that the Bible was rarely appealed to, was rarely used, that mainly was a matter of discussing organizational policy and how to apply this organizational policy. And I found that again and again, when issues came up, even though scriptures might be presented, if there was an organizational policy, that policy would take precedence over scripture. And I couldn't help but think of Jesus' words in Matthew 23, that they have made the word of God null and void because of their tradition.
After seeing that, we see that there's a huge deception blowing through the Watchtower Society of Jehovah Witnesses. So how in the world do they spread all of this deception? Well, it is all due to their extraordinary Watchtower magazine literature, which is written by the governing body themselves, who are simply men on a power trip. The Watchtower magazine discourages any individual thinking among the witnesses, and it requires them to submit to the teachings of the man-made Watchtower organization. In essence, Jehovah's Witnesses are all forbidden to read the Bible by themselves, meaning that it is only through the Watchtower magazine that the witnesses can learn the Bible, which results in taking scriptures out of context and creating rules that are not in the Bible. Now, here are a few out of thousands of the crazy quotes found in Jehovah's Witness literature. The extent of the Jehovah's Witness printing operation is truly unbelievable. The Watchtower Society now operates 15 printing facilities all throughout the world, practically everywhere but Antarctica. Now let's consider some figures from 2013 that I found. The Watchtower and the Awake, the Jehovah's Witness principal journals, are printed in over 210 languages and are currently the two of the most widely circulated magazines in the whole world. For each issue of the Watchtower magazine you hold in your hand, there are another 45 million copies. That is crazy impressive. That is insane. The Jehovah's Witness organization achieves this by volunteers who run their printing presses. Their printing machines are so advanced that they could print over 200,000 magazines per hour. And last year alone, the printeries produced more than 1.3 billion magazines and an additional 80 million books and Bibles. That is how they convince people. That is how people find out about them. That is truly scary. And recently, in 1961, the Jehovah's Witnesses translated and published their complete New World Translation of the Holy Scriptures. And let me tell you, it is very different from our original King James Version Bible. That is even more scary. In fact, any credible biblical scholar will tell you how fraudulent their version of their so-called Bible really is. From dozens of missing verses to changed context, this Bible is actually all about denying Jesus Christ and the Holy Trinity.
I have never found any so-called translation that goes so far away from what the scripture actually teaches as these books published by Jehovah's Witnesses. They are so far away from what there is in the original Hebrew and the original Greek. It's deceptive because they deliberately changed words in a passage of scripture to make it fit into their doctrine. They distorted the scripture in many passages, scores and scores of passages in the New Testament, dealing with the deity of Christ especially.
This is extremely dangerous, especially for those who are new to the Christian faith. Witnesses believe that Jesus Christ is a spirit creature, a super angel, the first creation of Jehovah God, who prior to coming to earth as a man, existed in heaven as Michael the Archangel. Jesus started out originally as the Logos, or Michael the Archangel, who then came to earth as the virgin-born son of Mary. He was perfect and a sinless man, but according to the witnesses, he was only a man. Devoid of all divinity, Jesus Christ walked the earth as a man, becoming the Christ only when he was baptized. Jehovah's Witnesses also hold the cross in great contempt, feeling that it was nothing more than a pagan symbol used by apostates. Instead, they teach that at the completion of his ministry, Jesus died not on the cross, but on an upright post. Christ's body was then laid in a tomb where it was then disintegrated by God. They literally mean that the body, Jesus Christ's body, totally was destroyed forever. Jesus was then recreated by his Father. And before going to heaven, he materialized in different bodies on different occasions to convince his disciples and others that he had been truly resurrected. How does this make sense? Jesus returned to his Father in heaven, where once again he became Michael the Archangel. He will never again be seen on the earth in a visible form, but instead rules invisibly from the heavens. When he executes judgment over the world during Armageddon, he will destroy all but the faithful witnesses. Jesus, alias Michael, will always remain in invisible form to those on earth and can only be seen by the 144,000. The Jehovah's Witnesses are also told that you may not look to Jesus alone for everlasting life, but in fact must depend on the Watchtower organization for their passage to paradise. In turn, the organization says that Jehovah's Witness is required to earn his salvation, largely by going door to door, where the Jehovah's Witnesses desperately seek to convert and baptize people of all faiths to their doctrine. Today, when the new Jehovah's Witnesses baptize, rather than using the biblical format of baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the witness is baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit-directed organization. And once baptized, the witness is now committed to be a slave for the organization until the world comes to an end. After this, they find out the strict and rigid existence of their environment. They realize their true reality. Jehovah's Witnesses cannot vote, recite the Pledge of Allegiance, or hold any elective office. They cannot salute the flag, sing the national anthem, or participate in any other patriotic activities. Jehovah's Witnesses cannot serve in the military. They cannot serve as police officers. They can't celebrate any holidays, including even small ones like birthdays or Mother's or Father's Days. They cannot play sports. They're forbidden to continue with higher education such as college or university. They cannot attend school functions or such as school clubs or dances. They cannot associate with other non-witnesses. They're restricted from sitting alone in the same room with the opposite sex for more than 30 seconds. They may not accept or give blood transfusions, read anything critical of the Watchtower Society, use the internet except for the Jehovah's Witness made website, jw.org, and they are even forbidden to attend church. And this is just a few of the many. Life is very narrow for the adult witness, to say the least. But the problem is even greater among the Jehovah's Witness children, as one can imagine. If a Jehovah's Witness is to commit any of the forbidden acts I just recited, they can face extreme punishment and must appear before a judicial committee of elders, where public censure and even disfellowshipping can be the sentence of this court-like meeting. When a Jehovah's Witness is actually disfellowshipped or excommunicated, he or she is publicly shunned by the whole organization and even their immediate families, much like the Amish community. There are thousands of unfortunate cases of ex-witnesses who have lost everything, sometimes even leading to their suicides. The ones that get out safely will likely become atheists and Satanists, and most will eventually just lose all their faith for our true God. There are a few that escaped believing in Christianity, but they are few and far in between. Thousands of children who are born into the Witness organization end up leaving this cult every year. But sadly after, they start seeing our Lord as the bad guy and Satan as the good guy. And that was all a part of Charles Taze Russell's scheme all along. To put it simply, the Jesus Christ that is being portrayed through the Watchtower's teachings is not the same Jesus of the true Christianity or of the Bible. Please, please, please be aware of the danger of this organization. Think of it like this. Imagine a stranger approaches you and says they know your buddy John, but all of their facts about John are wrong. You can then safely conclude that they're referring to a completely different John. Now, with that in mind, there are many religions that claim they know and believe in Jesus Christ, but that doesn't mean they're referring to the same Jesus of the Bible. For example, Mormons believe that Jesus was the spirit brother of Lucifer. Jehovah's Witnesses believe that Jesus is Michael the Archangel. Muslims believe Jesus was just a prophet. Notice that none of these religions teach exactly what the Bible says, that Jesus was God in human flesh. You see, the real Jesus sparked more controversy than any other religious leader in history. He made radical claims. He spoke not from, but with authority. And with that same authority, he forgave people of their sins. He healed without medicine. He fed thousands from one boy's lunch. He's the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes before the Father but through him. Jesus was ultimately crucified because he claimed to be God. He then conquered death by rising from the grave, just as he said he would. How is that? Because he's the Lord of all lords, the King of all kings. He is our Savior. He is God incarnate. Today, the Watchtower Society is quick to deny any of what I'm telling you. From the end of the world prophecies, to the missing verses in the New Translation Bible, to the Charles Taze Russell Freemasonic connection. In fact, the Jehovah's Witness organization is deathly scared of the internet. But we must always watch out for these evils, research and question everything. So on that note, I want to wish you all a beautiful and blessed week. This was Spy Kitten with a Spy Kitten TV approved message. Comment, like, and subscribe for more content.